renowned person in this part of the country. Over to you, Mr. Kamal Jain.
Thank you, Mr. Kiran Gubba, for organizing such an important, wonderful webinar with a subject like challenges in the movement of goods in the pharma industries and related solutions. This is a need of our webinar, and I'm confident at the end of the webinar, the people will have something takeaway, some information to be implemented in their respective industry. We have an eminent panelist with us who are going to speak about their experience in this subjective matter. I welcome all the panelists and the participants in this webinar. As all of you are aware, the WHO declared COVID-19 as pandemic, a deadly disease. And in order to reduce the severity and community spread, the government of India has locked down the country on 25th March. When they lock down the country, the whole country is restricted for the movement, whether it's a goods, whether it's a people and the vehicle. Pharma industry were allowed to operate being the essential commodity. Initially, the vehicles are allowed to move only with the who are carrying the essential commodities. Later on, they were allowed with the import and export cargo also. We need to understand one importance of the pharma industry, that we are, as a pharma industry, Indian pharma industry is contributing 40% of the global demand. We contribute to the global requirements and the domestic requirement, but we source 70% of the raw material from China, which is badly affected by the coronavirus, and whole supply chain lines are paralyzed, supply commitment are poor, responses in the various vertical of the supply chain is poor, commitment level are low. In such situation also, the pharma industry has to deliver. They have to serve the humanity, they have to serve the economy. But the supply chain system are interdependent and pharma. Effective pharma can happen only when you have effective supply chain system. We have a disruption in the global economy. The choices are limited, freight options are limited, things freight is becoming costlier. And in such situation, we have to work out a solution. Every company who are the part of this complete supply chain system has to work on the innovative plans, a different something which has not happened previously, because this is not a situation which we have come across earlier also. So everybody is learning and doing on the job. We have different panelists who have experience in this sector. They are well connected on ground. So as a part of our program, first I would like to call upon Mr. Satish Lakharaju, who is expert in supply chain of pharma products, delivering the goods across the globe, monitoring it, representing an international freight forwarding company, Agility Logistics. So Satish bhai, with such disruption and the limitation, how do you plan the commitment level? How do you serve the pharma industry with difficulty where the absenteeism is high, the motivation of people are low, there is a widespread panic? So over to you, Satish bhai.
Thank you to the Gubba team for hosting the webinar. My fellow panelists, Saurabh, Lakshmi Prasanna, Bibhu Bhushan, and Rahul Agarwal, and my dear friend Kamal Jain. I think it's a situation for which most of the people were not prepared, unfortunately. And so today, whatever is happening is you are taking decisions which are very much based on spot decisions and which are changing dynamically. But in case of us as Agility, for us, one major advantage that came up is that we were prepared a little earlier than most of them because we learned from China what had happened. So on March 11th, we almost were, mentally prepared for something of this. And I was myself in Hyderabad on March 11th, 12th, and 13th. I did meet most of the pharma companies, the big ones, and then told them that what you all are predicting or expecting, because 10th was Holi, if you all remember, and because of Holi, lot of these movies, that such a situation would ever arise, you know. So that's point number one. So what we've done in the process is that we have moved everyone to work from home. Whoever can do documentation, whoever can do all work from home, so including the printers and the rest of them. So more than 85 to 90% of the staff currently are work from home. We've also done, additionally, what we've done is that the operational staff are located at the nearby hotels close to the airport wherever required. You know, for them to travel at this point of time would not be easy, especially in the large metros like Bombay and the rest of them. So we've gone ahead and asked employees who are voluntarily to come in. Senior management has been speaking to most of the employees at the ground level, because it's not easy for their families to understand that, you know, why should they be going out? Why only they should be going out? So we have been talking to them. I have spoken to a lot of them who would never even imagine in their life, especially in the Hyderabad boys, because they are the front end boys. And it took quite some time for Hyderabad to even get their passes, so for them to travel. So to answer your point, first was we did a lot of preparation in terms of the back-end operations. We have a call center at Chennai, which is running 24/7. So which basically means today our operations are not centralized, decentralized at respective places, but more of a decentralized to a centralized model. So that on people can work in shift and documents can be processed faster. Ground level people are being motivated and being done wherever accommodation can be provided. We are also then giving, you know, our incentives for people who are taking the way out. In terms of partnership with customers, having worked for so long, also are cooperating to the largest extent. Today, the situation is not who is my competitor, but I think the situation today is that how can we partner, empathize, and work together with each other? So I think that is how we have made progress from the 21st of March quite successfully. But there is a long journey still to go. Okay, so those are my opening remarks, Kamal, for you to start.
Thank you, Satish Bhai. A good takeaway. The most important point is when we have not come across with this type of situation, go back to the client and asking them, how can you contribute to your business? A mutual communication basis where we will be listening to each other and taking the spot decision. Got it, Satish Bhai. And now I would like to hear from Mr. Vibhu Bhushan, who has been struggling from first mile to the last mile, that is from the point of production to the point of consumption. Mr. Vibhu Bhushan, please share your experience, how you are managing that.
Can I introduce Mr. Vibhu?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, over 22 years of rich experience in managing end-to-end supply chain operations, having functional expertise in forecasting demand, planning, production, and supply planning, procurement, contract manufacturing, inventory, management, logistics, distribution, warehouse, and transport, etc. Associated with leading companies like United Phosphorus, Cadila Pharma, Pyramid Healthcare, Indian Immunologicals, Biologically, in the pharmaceutical industry, creative mindset to generate innovative solutions, easy to get along, motivated team player, skilled in managing the large team. He is a qualified chartered accountant and completed management development program from IIM Ahmedabad. Over to you, sir. So you have to unmute yourself.
Vibhu, you are muted.
Mr. Bibu, you have to unmute yourself. Mr. Bibu, you have to unmute yourself. You unmute yourself. Okay, we are trying out to unmute.
Yeah,
Bibu.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
Okay, it's okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Kiran Gubba, for a nice introduction. Good afternoon, panel members and the participants. As all of us know that India is the largest exporter of pharmaceutical formulation. In terms of formulation in the globe, India is number one in terms of exporting of pharma formulation. and we export it to most of the countries, and the similarly there is certain part of the import also happening, particularly for the APIs, the key starting materials, the other excipients from the, so we have a large part of import as well, and we are Mr. Komaljan said, we are largely dependent on China for the APIs or the KSMs. So so far we never discussed about the availability of infrastructure or movement of goods, export import happening such a large scale, but because of the situation, the pandemic situation which we are going through now there is a the call of the hour is to discuss on how we can move, how can we keep the commitment to the customer on export front, and how can we regularize the import so as we can, our production can go on consistently. So that is the challenge for us in the pharma movement, and I think this is the right time when Mr. Kiran Gubba arranged this type of webinar, and he has appropriately given a subject to the discussion. He said that the pharma movement and the challenges in pharma movement, and the next 1 hour we are going to deliberate on those aspects. Now coming to the question, what he said, that what are the issues we faced when this happened? Actually, we never thought of, like Mr. Lakaraju said, that they had some sense that this is going to happen. The lockdown is the first experience of most of us in, I think this generation is for the first time the country is going for such a lockdown. So it was certainly unexpected. And when the lockdown announced by Honorable Prime Minister, our company's HR person simply gave us a call saying that you are not going to come to the office from tomorrow. So that is the immediate decision taken by the management. So we said, we'll take time to understand what kind of lockdown it is. So we prevented immediately the employees to come to the plant. So it was a complete shutdown. Then it took about 2 days to get the clarity from the central government, which comes to the state government, on what kind of relaxation they are going to give. So there are some relaxation conditional norms for the essential goods and medicines, which is part of the essential goods. So then only we started planning how to go about it and continue our workflow in the given conditional relaxation. So, but the major challenge was there was no clarity or misunderstanding between the GO from the central government and the state government. And when it comes to state government, when you deal with the local police station, they are not aware of what kind of relaxation was given to. So it took time, 3-4 days to them, that there are some relaxation, they are going to give us passes. So we coordinated with the police station near to our plants. We arranged for passes for our people to move. But more than the challenge was the panic of the employees. They are not clear about what is going to happen. They only said that it is a lockdown and you are not supposed to come because something is coronavirus, which is transferred from human to human. So you are not supposed to come out. The major challenge before the HR to call up each and employees, even for the HODs, to call, get in touch with each employees to clarify them what is the status, how the company is going to deal with it. So I think the day third or day fourth onwards, our people started coming with limited passes. Now I think they have made it, we are operating at about 50 to 60% scale. So the operation is going on, people are coming to factory, people are coming to office, but not in the normal scale. The other issue is the movement of goods, like because it was the March, the last month of the financial year, then everybody has a target to achieve. Right, I'm clear too, I'm audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah, so there was a challenge to close the financial year, then the movement of goods was a challenge. It's not for the sales closing, it is to ensure that the medicine is applicable. People started buying panically. 1 month requirement, they used to buy 3 months. So to prevent the shortage or scarcity of the medicine from the market, to prevent the hoarding by some of the people who are dealing with the pharmaceutical goods. We have a forum, actually, Pharma Supply Chain Head Forum. So it is, I think, more than 100 pharma companies are in that forum. So we use that platform, and we had our first meeting on 7th of April. We invited Mr. K.G. Ananta Krishna, who is Director General OPPI. We invited Mr. Tara Patel from IDMM, they are the Pharmaceutical Manufacturer Association. Then we invited Mr. Manoj Singh of GBK Mumbai Airport. We have with us Mr. Shiva Shailam. He's a special secretary for logistics appointed by Government of India to ensure the movement of goods. Then we had from all the transporters, like Rahul Agarwal is there with us, he's from Kulex. He is involved in transportation of the perishable consignments, perishable pharma products. So we had our first meeting, and you will not believe the kind of support given by each stakeholder, and unbelievable support by the government agencies. And their approach, their 24/7 approach, they have given their numbers to contact for any of the things. I think we had another round of meeting on 17th of April, wherein we had the people from Air India, who on our request, they have arranged for a flight from Frankfurt to India for the import consignment to come. So I think this is the first time we say that all people come together to achieve only one objective, that making the product, making the pharmaceutical goods available to all the people. So we had a motto saying that it's stress to serve. So everybody in the supply chain, all the stakeholders in the supply chain, involved in the supply chain, they stretched themselves to serve the country, to serve the people of the nation by ensuring availability of the medicine at the doorstep. But the challenge still remains. Where the challenge still remains is moving the product now even from the wholesaler to the retailer, because the patient will come to the retail shop to buy the medicines. So we are now approachable to the wholesaler. Wholesaler to retailer is something, it is not so far addressed, it is not normalized. I think in our last meeting, as I said on 17th April, we invited TCI Freight, we invited Spot and Courier, we invited Gati to be part of the discussion, and all of them ensure that from Monday onwards, they started their operation all India. And I believe for essential goods and pharmaceutical goods, will not have much issues in the days to come. It will be streamlined very soon.
Yeah. Sarji, I think you're... Yeah. Over to you, Kamalji. Hello?
Appears Kamal line is...
I think Kamal... Over to Mr. Kamal Jain.
I think...
Sorry,
it's okay.
Done from the Mr. Bibu side. So we have another panelist who is contributing in another vertical of the logistics known as custodian. Mr. Saurabh Kumar is a custodian to the Air Cargo Complex, Hyderabad, representing GMR. I request Mr. Kiran Gubba to introduce Mr. Saurabh Kumar.
Mr. Saurabh is a supply chain and strategic professional with a nearly 2 decades of experience in aviation, global logistics, infrastructure, retail, and telecom sectors. He is currently the Chief Executive Officer of GMR Hyderabad Air Cargo, and he has been with GMR Group since 10 years and led the strategic planning function for several GMR businesses. That is Hyderabad International Airport, City, and Special Economic Zone. Prior to joining GMR Group, Saurabh worked in Mumbai with Ernst & Young, Tata Strategic Management Group, in the strategy and business consulting space. Over to you, Mr. Saurabh, to add value.
Yeah, Saurabh bhai, as a custodian, the responsibility of yours is to store the cargo on behalf of the custom and to act on behalf of the airlines. But in the lockdown period, we have seen you have gone little extra. You have devised certain innovative plan to join the stakeholders, created certain innovative steps where the stakeholder can come closer to take the delivery and manage their import and exports. I've seen personally certain things you have done which were not common as a custodian, but those were the appreciable move by you. We would like to hear from you how you are managing the things, what are the difficulty you are facing, and how do you see the prospect of the cargo?
Thanks, Kamalji. Hope I'm audible, clear?
Yes, you are audible.
So I think you mentioned about the responsibilities of custodian and being a custodian. I think as part of the group, we are operating the Hyderabad airport in its entirety, along with all our stakeholders. And one of the key responsibilities has been to keep the cargo airport or the cargo side of the airport operational during this tough time. In fact, right from the day one when the lockdown was announced on 24th March, close to that, I think it was clear that the movement of cargo will happen. The airport will not close for cargo freighters. So I think from that time till now, I think the biggest challenge we face and we are trying to overcome is to how to keep the airport running, how to keep it operational to receive the freighters, receive the import, process the export, and also how do we and what is the extension of this we can do in terms of facilitating the city side movement. I think with this objective, I wanted to highlight that so far, as far as Hyderabad is concerned, there has been no decrease in the number of cargo freighters that has been coming to Hyderabad. In fact, on a weekly basis, there is about 12 to 14 freighter aircrafts, which are regularly coming to Hyderabad. I think where we are seeing an impact is coming from the passenger aircraft, which has stopped coming to Hyderabad because of the lockdown. And so there is a huge demand for the cargo freighters. I also wanted to update that sensing this demand, there are several airlines who have started converting their passenger aircraft into cargo aircraft and running. And you'll be happy and surprised to see that airlines such as Qatar, Emirates is almost coming on a daily basis. It's every day, I think, Emirates is coming and taking almost 40 tons. Qatar is coming one or two extra additional aircraft, which are passenger converted aircraft. We are also having additional charters, which are coming. So what's happening is that while the passenger side of the capacity has gone because of the lockdown, the freighter capacity has increased because of the additional passenger to cargo, as well as the turnaround freighters, which are coming for addressing the needs of the catchment area. So I think one of the biggest challenge which we faced was to ensure that first our resources are in place. And when I say resources, it's primarily to do with employees, primarily to do with availability of all the equipments and machinery. So I think there we worked out a detailed plan. We figured out where our employees are staying, where our staff are staying, and we worked out a very innovative, approach, which is very scalable considering the cargo movement. If we are expecting, say, 200 tons, we are able to scale up. If you're expecting 50 tons, we are able to scale down. And by this, what we try to do is to ensure that only the required number of minimum people who come to cargo terminal and ensure their health, safety, and social distancing aspect. Later, we also realized that while the cargo is coming, there is challenge of it's getting evacuation, it's evacuation to the city. While the import is coming, how do these go reach out to the, consignee and the warehouse of the customers? And that's where we realized, and we had a good discussion, and Kamalji was saying all the trade along with customs. We figured out that, yes, if we need to work together. So I think custodian, as well as a great contribution from customs, we together took it up with police, local administration. And we worked out a mechanism where we identified the need, the essential staff from each of the company, and we started, certifying them, their need, and we started issuing a very specific approval in consultation with the local police. And as on date, you'll be surprised that we have issued around a few hundred such permits, which allows for the essential staff to come and manage the city side thing. Then we faced with another problem that there are some people who come, who wants to use public transport, but there are no public transport. So I think that's where we work with the CHA Association and the freight forwarder, cargo agent association, to figure out, okay, if we can run certain trips to facilitate their movement from the prominent points in the city into the cargo.
So that's also going on. And you know, one more challenge last, and I'll close with this, because yes, there are challenges which are evolving and we are working on it as a team, as a trade. You know, the need for not coming to counters, not coming to a terminal for everything. So I think we had a session wherein a few of the trade members came together and worked out how we can work and try to reduce the contact for exchange of paper, exchange of documentation. I think that is something that we are working, and in the next few days, we'll work out a mechanism where we'll at least try to reduce the interactions by 50% to see that at least not so many times people should not come to the counter. I think these are some of the areas, Kamalji, where as a custodian, as an airport, we identified that yes, we need to work upon. And I'm sure in times to come, this is going to help us to improve the overall productivity.
Thank you, Mr. Saurabh. And I appreciate the measures taken by the custodian beyond their responsibility, whether it's a reduction in the number of papers, whether it's a reduction in the contact points, the sanitation method employed, and the most important is the consultation with the industry. Because unless you consult with the industry, you will not be able to know what is the requirement on the other side, whether it's a custom broker or the freight forwarder. Now we would like to hear from a representative from Pharma Excel. I request Kiran to introduce Lakshmiji.
Yeah, Ms. Lakshmi Prasanna is heading the regulatory division, which is critical of Pharma Excel and guides the Pharma Excel members on the regulatory challenges in the overseas markets. She is the focal point between the Pharma Excel and China, critical most. China Chamber of Commerce for import and exports of medicines, health products. Prior to joining the Pharma Excel, she served as a regulator for the drugs inspector and auditor in the state government of Andhra Pradesh. She is a central council member of All India Drugs Controller Officers Confederation. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you for my introduction. Very good afternoon to all the fellow panelists and all the members. And I extend my sincere thanks to Gubba team for having me on the board in place of our Director General, Mr. Uday Bhaskar. Hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, fine. So the challenges the Pharma Excel has faced, especially started before the onset of COVID in the country itself. As far as I understand, all the stakeholders, all the panelists here have started finding out the challenges and working on the challenges when the onset of COVID in the country happened. But Pharma Excel has come into picture when the COVID attack outbreak happened in China, and we have started working out how the supply chain disruption should be monitored and controlled further to see that there is no disruption in the exports of Indian pharmaceuticals. It's there. We started working and we have identified what are all the major molecules that India is heavily depending on China, the key starting materials and active pharmaceutical ingredients and all. And we have been in regular contact with the Indian embassies in Shanghai and Beijing, and we hold a number of discussions to see that there is no further impact on the Indian pharma industry and pharmaceuticals. Subsequently, as the time progresses, China has succeeded in containing this COVID-19 spread, and we have started receiving the supplies from China. And right now, there is complete production units have restored in China, and we have almost receiving almost 70 to 80% of supplies from China. But again, the scenario in India is right now in a tough situation compared to the Chinese condition. So since the announcement of lockdown in the country, that all the pharma industry were in a panic state, and they were not knowing what is going to happen. The same case with the Pharma Excel. And immediately after the announcement of this lockdown, many number of industry associations such as IDMA and BDMA have approached Pharma Excel to find out the solution that the industry could evolve the solutions for all the problems at hand. So then we have represented all the issues. I mean, we have contacted all the industry members, major stakeholders, and the industry associations. And we have collected the major issues what they're facing, whether it is of a transportation issues or employee issues or freight issues or cargo or any other logistics. What are all the issues they're facing? We have collected and we have approached the concerned ministries. Indeed, all the ministries have very much favorable to the recommendations of the Pharma Excel, especially the Ministry of Commerce, the our parent ministry, and even the Department of Pharmaceuticals, which is the key agency looking after the essential availability of the medicines in the country. And we have regularly following with all the ministerial agencies, and we have apprised the difficulties of the industry to the aviation ministry and also the shipping ministry and the home affairs. Subsequently, we could able to convince the ministries, and they have come forward with the relaxation to the pharma industry and the essential services and all. So we have seen some of the relaxations given by the shipping ministry in terms of demurrages exemption and other fee payments and all. And even we have raised the concern of the industry, especially with the air freight cargoes and all. And we requested this aviation ministry to reserve the space for medicines for both import and export. And also for the conversion of this passenger aircraft. So we could able to see some positive results from all these ministries as well. And recently, there were some issues, especially in Baddi area, where the personal movement, the laborer movement has been restricted from other states of Haryana and Himachal Pradesh. So we have also taken up this issue with the Home Ministry, and the ministry has also instructed all the state governments to see that no manufacturing unit should suffer, especially no pharmaceutical manufacturing unit must suffer. So the government is very much supportive and encouraging the industry. And we are so proud that Pharmaxil is working on behalf of all the pharma industry to see that there is no disruption in the entire supply chain mechanism, and there is no scarcity of the essential medicine in the country as well as in the global arena also. And on the other side, as you all know, the India is the pharmacy of the world, and we have been exporting large number of generics to the entire world, to almost all the countries. And we have been coined as a pharmacy of the world, as you everybody knows. And we could see this is, one side we could see this is a challenge for the country. And at the other side, we could see this is one kind of an opportunity for the entire pharma industry. Almost 10 or 15 years back, when the HIV was very prevalent in Africa, India has come forward in offering the affordable anti-HIV medicines. And then and there, the global image of India has risen as a pharmacy of the world. And we feel this is the time that India is also could able to increase the level of the position in the global health arena. And this is the opportunity for Indian companies to prove its image in the global healthcare system. And even right now, everybody must be hearing in the news that entire world is looking for hydroxychloroquine towards India. Mm-hmm. And of course, there were some restrictions imposed by the government to protect the national interest for these essential medicines. But at the same time, once we assured that there are enough quantities of these drugs are available in the country for the nation's population, the government has taken a decision to supply these essential medicines to other countries. And till date, we could able to supply almost 80 million tablets of hydroxychloroquine to almost 105 nations. In fact, we are so proud to prove again the country as a pharmacy of the world. And we look forward to continue the support from India to entire globe in very much needed times like this COVID-19. And apart from this, if we talk about the API dependence on China, so from government side and from Pharmaxil side, so to combat this situation, we have strategically devised two kind of a mechanism to overcome this dependency. So in a short term, the government has devised a task force which regularly monitors the availability of the medicines, wherein we have identified the basic database of the molecules for which we are depending on China and the major suppliers from China's side. And this task force is continuously monitoring the availability of the medicines from Chinese. And we have been closely coordinating with the ambassadors in Shanghai and Beijing that there is no further supply chain disruption from the Chinese company. So this is a short-term plan that we are following right now. And whereas in the case of long-term plan, so this COVID situation, we don't know. This is very uncertain times that for how long we could be able in the same kind of situation. But this is the high time that we have to realize the position of India in the global pharma industry. Earlier days, like a couple of decades back, India is very much strong in active pharmaceutical ingredients. But those days are gone. Nowadays, we have been heavily relying on China. Of course, we are very much strong in generic formulations. But in case of APIs, especially fermentation products and antibiotics, we are very, very much relying on China. The same kind of a molecules, we were having our own capabilities at the two decades back. But right now we have lost those pace and we have started working towards the generics. But this is the high time that we have to regain our capabilities back and we have to start working on this. In fact, Formexil, we have done a study almost a couple of years back on these strategies for the government to overcome the dependency on China. And we have done a detailed project report and we have submitted that report to the government almost a year back. So basing on the recommendations, what Formexil has suggested, the government has taken up these suggestions immediately during the lockdown. On 21st of March, the government has announced a pharma policy. So, and this is the long-term strategy that the government is following to overcome the dependency on China. So under this pharma policy, the government has given, has come up with the two different schemes. One scheme called as a bulk, a scheme for bulk drug manufacturing facilities in the country, pharma clusters. So the government has approved three pharma clusters in three different states, and it is going to allocate 1,000 crore fund for each of the clusters. So this is one big boost for the entire Indian industry to facilitate the industry to strengthen their capabilities and to reduce the over-dependency on China. So because of this pharma clusters, the government provides the common infrastructural facilities like effluent treatment plants or common storage facilities or testing facilities and all. So this is a one major support being given by the government to reduce this dependence. And on the other side, the government has come up with another scheme called production-linked incentive scheme, wherein the molecules what we have identified that the India is heavily relying on China. So the manufacturers of those molecules have given a financial incentives by the government. And under this scheme, the government has allocated almost 6,940 crores in coming 8 years. So these two schemes, we believe these two schemes will definitely encourage the Indian industry to strengthen their capabilities in production of these raw materials, of these starting materials and active pharmaceutical ingredients. And in way forward, the Indian industry could become strong, not only in the generics space, but also in the API space. And this is the time, and this is the opportunistic time for the Indian government, that the entire world is looking at China in a suspicious way. That, either directly or indirectly, China is responsible for this kind of a scenario in the entire globe. And even so, the nations like United States and European Union are seriously thinking they should have an alternative supplier for the medicines, because either directly or indirectly, China is almost controlling the entire globe in pharma space in the form of active pharmaceutical ingredients. So now the developed nations and even the developing nations are looking at an alternative place, alternative destination of the pharmaceuticals. And we believe India can grab that opportunity in the space of API. Of course, India is very strong in genetics. And this is the time that India could prove the capacities and capabilities in the API space also. So in the future, we are so optimistic that India could evolve in that space. And on the challenges side, yes, we are regularly taking up all the issues of the industry and even the supply chain members and all, and we are negotiating with all the concerned ministries to sort out the best possible solutions for the members. And I'm so glad for this opportunity to talk, and I'm happy to take up any of the specific challenges that the industry or any of the stakeholders are facing, so that we can take up the issues with the concerned ministries. Thank you so much.
Appreciate Lakshmi ji for giving lot of information in such a short time, so we could know, the participant could know about how the PharmaExcel is doing the work, whether it's international diplomacy or whether it is creating an opportunity for Indian pharmaceutical manufacturer and creating a way that the supply lines are continued and the various schemes, and even to the smaller level of the labor problem at the Himachal Pradesh and the Baddi level. We appreciate the efforts of PharmaExcel for promoting the pharma sector. Now we have another speaker, Mr. Rahul Agarwal, who is from the transport side. And when the lockdown started, every system, whether it is from the rickshaw puller to the airlines, everybody got affected. And so as the economy got affected. So I request Kiran Gubba to introduce Mr. Rahul Agarwal so that we can take up further for his views about industry, because he is the most important factor in delivering the first mile as well as the last mile and the most sought after person in this particular situation.
Absolutely. Hum sab bogi hai and Rahul is the engine. We all, whatever we do, ultimately we have, logistics is the carrier to take things from A to the final destination. In fact, what do I talk about, Rahul? Everybody, the entire pharma industry, virtually the entire pharma industry knows about Rahul. Mm-hmm. His family, his company, Kulex. It's been more than 30 years and 30 years into pharma, and probably there's no company that Rahul's company might have served, right from the big deliveries to the last mile delivery. And he has been in the industry for more than 30 years. I think Rahul, what should I talk about the fish? The water knows it. So over to you, Rahul.
Thanks, Kiran, for the overwhelming introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. So Mr. Bibhu has spoken about the, Pharma Distribution Heads Forum, and I think that forum has, been active right from the time this lockdown has started. And fortunately, we were able to interact with all the stakeholders where we were facing problems. For example, the transporters. So we were able to get the All India Association of Transporters, their key members on board. From the government side, of course, Mr. Siva Selam was kind enough to continuously be active with us. He's still on the chat group with us and he interacts on a daily basis. We were facing issues with the air cargo in Bombay Mail, and we had Manoj on board. He's still on board. They've been doing a great job. I'm sure Hyderabad and Bangalore and Delhi are also doing an equally great job. I think the air cargo agencies, have been extra active and, going out of their way to make sure that, the cargo that is coming in and going out gets cleared. So, in fact, for example, from the Bombay airport, we were also receiving daily data of the cargo that is being held up and not being cleared for, so many reasons. So one of the things that came out about 10 days ago was we found that a lot of the cold chain products, which were not falling under the pharma category, especially chemicals and those kind of products, which were also taking up a lot of space in the air cargo, were not being cleared because, those companies thought that being a non-essential product, the government would not allow them to transport it out of the port and take it into their plants. And with the help of the Transport Association, we were able to reach out to almost each one of them and, help decongest the airport. And that was a great help because, the cycle restarted. Even though a lot of the airlines had stopped operating in the middle and, a lot of the air cargo got disrupted, but a lot of new charters came in and that helped ease out the burden, both whether it was import or export. Talking about domestic, I think the major challenge which we faced in industry, and I think Bibhu sir would probably concur with me, is the secondary part where, the movements were happening from the CFA to the stockist distributors. And initially we faced a lot of disruption there because the transporters are not willing to, start work. Of course, for so many reasons that their staff and the labor were out of action. And I think that has eased out, but still there is a challenge. The good news is that, if you look at the data that AIOCD publishes, sales between March and April from 1st to the 15th, the pharma industry across therapies has been able to maintain more than 85% of the, volumes in April vis-a-vis March, except for, the vaccine segment, which has taken a bit of a hit. But surprisingly, gastro and your anti-diabetic has oversold. It has gone to about 120-130% of, March, which could also mean a little bit of hoarding here and there, but then that's irrelevant in the current situation. Other than that, I think most of the pharma movements are happening. There's a tremendous government support. Bombay region, to just give you an example, Bombay being a very large area, we've got New Bombay, Thana Rural, from where the staff operates. So, we were facing challenges where, people had to come in from Bhiwandi and go to JNPT, or people had to come from Kalyan and come into Bombay airport. And because there was inter-commissionerate movements, we were facing a large challenge for people to move. So the good part was that we were able to, speak to the chief secretary, and, the commissionerates came on board and they started issuing us, inter-movement passes where, people could commute freely. So a lot of burden in this part of the country has also eased out. And I think the way we are seeing things, we should be coming back on track. I think the second half of April should see a better reach compared to the first quarter. Thank you.
Rahulji, good to hear that the pharma industry is doing good and the distribution are happening on time. And some of the medicines are being, oversupplied, maybe because, as Vibhu said, the people are buying out of the panic. That could be one of the reason, but it's a good news. Things are on track. And the most important part is, from the lockdown 1 to lockdown 2, the situation has been better every day. And the intermediate agencies are contributing each other and supporting each other for each other's benefit. The important aspect of the pharma is the warehousing.
Absolutely. See, warehousing is still a challenge, because we have a problem of the labor, not coming to the warehouses. So even in the first part of April, when we restarted the movements to CFAs, and when the trucks would reach upcountry, we would find that the CFAs are also not operational because their own staff has not come. So that problem is being faced even today. Take, for example, Bhiwandi. If I have to load a cargo at an ex pharma company, the first thing the company says is, sir, we don't have any manpower. Can you send your labor along? And we say that we were expecting the same from your end. So this problem still remains. And we've been to the government to help us, allow labor movement, because most of them are migrants and have gone back to their respective hometowns. One of the peculiar problems that we face is, in most of these villages where the labor comes from, they have the panchayats. So, when they want to again come back, also the panchayat leaders are not allowing them to move out. And this is a genuine problem. And this is, something where the state governments at every level, whether it's Haryana or Bihar or UP or, Rajasthan, where the major chunk of the labor comes from, even, Jammu and Kashmir for that matter, unless the local bodies don't start acting and start allowing the labor, to move. Because they put a lot of moral binding on them, ki aap abhi jaoge kuch ho jayega, aap aaye ho, aap, maybe virus leke aaye ho, you need to be contained, what will happen to your family. So, they get morally pressured for moving out, whether it's the labor or the drivers. So, this problem is still a chronic problem, and if this is not resolved, we will probably see a little more pressure coming up in the coming weeks.
I think initially the lockdown one was about the jaan hai to jahan hai, and then jaan bhi aur jahan bhi, wo aane mein thoda sa time lagega logon ka mindset mein. And this problem, panchayat and labor problem, is quite genuine. We are also facing in the different sectors. Yes. So how do you see such type, and how do you manage such type of problem? We would like to hear from Mr. Kiran Gubba, who is expert in cold chain warehousing. And he has a lot of warehousing space and is serving a lot of pharmaceutical companies. Well-known person in the warehousing sector. Kiran, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. In fact, on the Janta curfew day itself, we took the first step. I mean, our MD is the president of Telangana Cold Store Association. So he went to the government on Janta curfew day itself to tell the government to put us, the cold storage, under essential commodities, such that we will be able to serve the food and the medicine out there. Else, the entire supply chain would be a jam, because we are a critical spoke in the wheel. And then the biggest thing, what like everybody out there facing, is we are also facing it. There's nothing new about us. People's management. If you look at the last many years also, we have been talking about people's management. It was at a back end. But since, say, a month or so, people's management has been the front end, day-to-day job. There are many, many instances. If you look at either it is Satish or Saurabh or Bibu or Kamal or anybody, Rahul, I don't know when is that you might have spoken to your HODs and their families, or motivated your down the level team to come up or empowered them. Those number of calls, I don't know when you did that. So like us also, the same thing. In fact, we, the key management, have already decided ki abhi bolna kam aur sunna jyada hai. Log to kafi bol rahe, but now we have to start listening, because people are very irritated, very upset, the emotions are very high, and they are very restless. It's time for us to listen to people, make them settle down. See, people start accepting it, then things will start moving. अभी सबके मन में एक ही है, कब ये लॉकडाउन खत्म हो जाता और हम ये जेल से कब निकलते. Everybody, like I mean, everybody wants a safe and a normal atmosphere, whether it is a CEO or down to the pallet truck operator. But things are not happening the way you want. So still you're resisting. So at some point of time, I said to my team, stop resisting it, Baba. Wo kab jayega, Ram jane. You don't become helter and skelter by resisting it. Start accepting it. Accepting it the way it is and the way it is not. अभी 7 तारीख तक तो हमारे तेलंगाना में छुटकारा नहीं है. सो वंस यू स्टार्ट एक्सेप्टिंग इट, देयर इज सम पीस वेयर यू आर नाउ. इफ आई एम एट पीस, आई कैन बी पीसफुली स्पीकिंग टू माय कोर टीम, वेदर इट्स माय जीएम, पीएम, एजीएम और वीपी और व्हाटएवर, एंड देन दैट जीएम विल बी पीसफुली स्पीकिंग टू हिज डाउन द लेवल टीम, एंड दैट इज हाउ पीस रीचेस टू द डाउन द लेवल. Again, I'm saying there's no right way of doing it. Keep listening to the people. Keep empowering them like never before. Be available for them. Let the team experience that, yes, the company is for me. They're taking care of me. Because one incident, trust me, one incident will convert the zone from green to red. The truck is leaving from Bombay and coming to Hyderabad. Beach may... some location has been converted from green to red. Khatam, the truck is gone. It's there. Suddenly there's a vacuum, there's a breakdown, there's an echo overnight. So because next day, see, the team come back to home and then go, get up and go back to office. They should be willfully coming to plants to work. So it's all the more not just creating the awareness of physical environment like safety standards, sanitizers or whatever. Also keep empowering them, be with them, keep speaking to them. I know down the ladder, everybody is busy now. In fact, we are doing more number of calls to do the same work. The bandwidth is consumed for getting things done. Yet, be there. In fact, I was very happy listening to Saurabh and like a couple of speakers here, like adequate arrangements have been done for people to stay in hotels. People have been taking some crazy decisions. Never ever it was done. In fact, it is our responsibility. I mean, our pharma industry, like everything, like all the end-to-end, the logistics, the cold storage, the pharma manufacturers, associates, keep communicating to the world, to India, especially to India, that we are no more less than the doctors, the nurses, the police people. We have actually demonstrating our duty for the past 20, 30 days. We are those, again, the unsung heroes who have been doing. That's it from my side, Kamal. That's what I keep telling to my people. I just keep speaking to them and ask them, like, khana khaya hai? Kya kar raha hai? How are you? That's the first thing I am asking nowadays to my people. And like Kamal said, someone said from the panelists, now it's not about, Satish said, it's not about kaun hai mera competitor. No. Kaha hai hamara maal? It's all about us now. It's the India fighting with the COVID. The humanity is getting, what you call, connected back. That is the beauty of, the other beauty of this COVID. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiran, for giving a wonderful message that there is a time to listen to the people, understand them. I think initially Satish also said that when we go to the client, we need to ask them, how can we contribute to their business? Similarly, we have to ask this question to our own people. How can we help you? How can we help you to come to our place and doing the essential services? How can we do the safety? How can we reduce the panic in the mind of you, your surrounding or the panchayat, and how we can continue the business? Now it's a time for the question and answer. The people have started questioning and answer. Before that, I would like to ask Satish, one important aspect is that when the people, a lot of people ask, freight rates are going high. And how do you see, how long will it continue? Because it's an important component for the pharma industry. It is making their costing more higher and the medicine more costlier. So how do you see the freights in the upcoming year, upcoming months?
Okay. I think this is not the first time I've been asked this question, and let's get to a context to understand how the freight rate is really worked around. I'm not from absolutely an airline side, but I think what we need to understand was that some time ago, the demand dropped so much that a lot of freighters had to be withdrawn. And then after the Janata curfew, no one presumed one particular day that the government, including DGC and Ministry of Civil Aviation, would take a decision to call back all the passenger aircrafts. And if you know that majority of the capacity, even out of Hyderabad, was driven by the belly capacity which was there in the aircraft. Today, the situation is that close to 60-65% of that belly capacity is not available with us. It is purely driven by freighters, and it is also driven by passenger aircrafts converted into cargo flights. Which basically means that the freight which used to be paid, or the fare that used to be paid by the passenger, is now added to the cargo. Since Bibhu Bhushan is here, for him to understand that today, since the passengers are not flying, that amount of the fare amount actually adds to the cargo. Unfortunately, this is the truth. Yeah. Kamal, as long as the flights don't come back and passengers don't move, the cargo rates are going to be skyrocketed. We have not seen a demand like this. I have never seen, having paid $1 million for a charter from Hyderabad to JFK, that's the current price at which it is going. 1100 to 1200 is the price that you see for Latin America today. For Bangkok from Hyderabad, the price went as high as 600 rupees. So these are unprecedented times. But my message to the industry is that, like I said in the starting, we are not competing, but if we can collaborate at this point of time, identify that particular routes where cargo has to travel and consolidate and start operating freighters, probably that will save a lot of lives, will save a lot of freight cost. It will help Hyderabad show itself as an united force to get cargo out from Hyderabad. I know Saurabh and the team are doing a brilliant job. I've seen the type of support that Hyderabad gets for the pharma industry. But I think there is a time that if the rates have to come up, then we need to collaborate better now at this point of time. So that will be my take for saying that the rates will continue to be high for a couple more weeks. Don't expect them to be dropped, because if the other production units start, then the aircrafts will be further demanded. I'm seeing a huge, huge demand for North America as we speak as well, even now.
Thank you, Satish. I think rates will be higher, will come down when things goes to the normalcy, the passenger aircraft will fly, because basically these are being compensated by the passenger. And collaboration is one of the solutions which can be looked upon, through which at least something better can happen. I would like to take the next question with Mr. Saurabh. Somebody is like to know how, what are the type of volumes Emirates and Qatar are carrying? Are they carrying the vegetables and the frozen item also?
So I think this is a question that I like a lot, because I think perishable is one of the segments that's quite close to me. So I think I personally work a lot to see we get a lot of vegetables to be exported, though Satish and all his friends don't, they all like pharma a lot. But we are on a pharma call, but I still, I'm happy that you asked me this question. First thing I want to tell, that as Satish is saying, that I think after the first shock of the first week, which is actually, you know, 20 to 30th of March, I think the capacities are gradually increasing. And I want to tell you that in the week one, we were at around 20% of the capacity. And today it is more than 50% of the capacity out of Hyderabad, which has been restored. And in the weeks to come, and as Satish is rightly saying, in just a couple of weeks, I think we just have to have a patience of few more weeks, we will reach to a level wherein the prices will start softening. Having said so, I think coming to the question, in terms of volumes, Kamal, we are handling more than 50% of our regular volume. And the traffic has increased by 3x, which means that in the first week, if I was handling about 100 tons, for example, now we are handling 300 tons per day. So I think there is a steady increase, and we see this level being sustained. And as and when the aircrafts are coming, because I'm quite surprised, you see, new airlines are coming and they're converting their passengers and they're running. I don't want to tell the names. And there are freighters which are coming, which have never seen Hyderabad in the last 10 years. And Satish will be bringing one of those freighters if he's talking about one minute, because it must be a good freighter. Right? So we are, so those, you know, you've not even heard of airlines. Those are the airlines which are coming to Hyderabad and going to come in the next 10 days. So I see it's we just need to manage our resources. And I think Mr. Kiran has spoken well. If we focus on people and give us a couple of weeks more, I think things will be back on track. Hope I've answered the question, Kamal.
Yes, you have answered the question. One important question is asked about the sanitization of the cargo. And I would like you and Bibhu both should answer respectively. When the cargo arrives and you take into your custody or you take into your warehouses, how to avoid the virus impact, and how do you see those type of sanitization? Because some of the cases took place in some pharma companies that the import cargo has impacted the people. So your views on that?
Yeah. So I think it's a very valid question, and there are two components to it. The first is the physical infrastructure, and the second thing is how do we protect as we do the business? I'll answer the second part first. We have rolled out new SOPs of how an employee, how a cargo, a staff working in the air cargo complex, a GMR air cargo terminal, has to handle a cargo which comes from import. So there is an SOP in terms of his PPE, which is personal protective equipment. There is an SOP with respect to the the touching and the distancing part while he's handling the cargo individually or as a team. The second part, talking about the cargo per se, wherever the cargo is placed in the infrastructure, I think much before the guidelines came, and I'm talking about around 25th or 24th of March, from that time onwards, we figured out, we have rolled out a process wherein periodically, after every few days, and this number of days is depending on the area we are covering and based on the expert advice, we are disinfecting, sanitizing the area, the cargo terminal area, where employees are working, where cargo is stored, where all the common touch points, which is happening, and these are being done through, approved, mild, and effective disinfectant. In fact, personally, I have done, just to understand the subject, and we are all in a new learning era curve, I have done good amount of understanding and research on which chemical, what kind of impact it has on people and material, what is the residue that it leaves, and which of them is effective but not harmful for body skin, so that we choose on the right service provider and right chemical. While doing so, I think we all need to understand that we just can't put a cargo a package or a pallet or a thing which has come from outside into a fountain of disinfecting liquid or water. It should not be done. It cannot be done, because if you are spraying any chemical on any of these parcels or as a packet as a whole, it leaves, depending on the chemical, certain ppm of residues, depending on 500 to 5000 ppm, depending on what you're using. So we have factored in all of those and releasing the cargo and maintaining the area. Having said so, whatever measures we do, it will be about handling of the cargo or the area where it is stored or the cargo per se, the overall. But once you open the cargo, and that is where the second part of your question, Kamal, you were asking, when you remove the raw materials and when you start using it, I think there starts another set of challenges. And I think I would leave Mr. Bhushan to address that part.
Bibhuji.
Yeah. So in pharmaceutical industry, we have also revised our standard operating procedure, both for the personnel as well as the material. In view of this COVID-19 situation. So the SOPs is revised for the movement of people as well as the material. There is a sanitization done at the receiving bay when we take out the material from our, when we offload the, you know, the material throughout our receiving bay, so that it has to go through a sanitization process before entering into the godown. So the special instruction is given to the people who are handling the cargo, just to handle as per the SOP and put it in respective bay in the warehouse. So there is some revision is made in the SOP.
Thank you, Vibhuji. Satish, anything your company or people are doing with respect to as a agent, freight forwarding agent, or the custom broker, what is to be done or what not to be done as a, to handle the cargo?
Okay. Fortunately, we have a quality, health, safety, environment policy originally in place. We also have a head of quality, and we also have a pharma head of quality in agility, already in place. So fortunately, all the concepts in terms of the hand sanitization to the rest of the aspects which we need to follow have been clearly outlined and guidelined. And the biggest thing that we've done is that the least amount of interface that is possible between the human beings also has been reduced. What I mean by that is that if you see whoever is not necessary in the office or in the warehouse, we have asked them to stay away, to come from to the office in the first place. Two, in respect to pharma, as much as far possible, we are picking it up from the customer's place and directly transmitting it into the airport itself, so that your interface also is drastically reduced. You know, you do a multiple storing, multiple handling, multiple repacking, then you are bound to expose it to a lot of risk also. Two, I think at this point of time, the critical aspect that everyone should know would be is that let all our trucks be sealed once completely, and not transmit pharma under, for heaven's sake, in open trucks or anything into any particular place. Because if you sanitize your trucks and then send it to them, and it is again sanitized at the factories and then loaded, and you bring it to, say, the pharma zone, then you are avoiding a lot of related risks that you see. So that will be our takeaway in terms of it, is to train your people, guide them, reduce the number of interfaces, sensitize the people that, look, what we are doing today is not an ordinary thing. We are here for patient safety. And I think everyone who is on this call and listening to me knows that in Hyderabad, we've been doing this conference called the Unbroken Cold Chain, which is best basically to educate people the important role that each one of us are playing to transfer pharma or transport pharma to this world, because we are going to save people's life. And any mistake that we do on the ground, contamination and the rest of them, will lead to larger issues also, ineffectiveness of the medicine. I think that sensitivization is what we have done in the organization. We have put in a lot of people in terms of it. We are not only CIB Pharma certified, we are GDP certified. We have B pharmacists in the sales team. They are not ordinary people. So my message to the industry is, please invest in people. They are the ones who will change your organization. There's no one else that can change it, but it is the people whom we should trust. We should train them. We should sensitivize them. Then they will make sure that these quality aspects are taken care of.
Kiranji, anything from your side, because your people also handle a lot of cargo. How do you react to the situation when import cargo comes to your warehouse, and what are the measures you take in this situation?
Yeah, we, as per the WHO guidelines, we follow the same protocol, what is needed. Of course, for the man movement, we are doing that sanitization. For the cargo, we do a deep cleaning and take the cargo inside. Yeah, that's what we are doing for now.
One interesting question somebody asked, because the whole world is like to know this particular thing, is from Vibhu Bhusandi, when do we have the vaccine for the COVID?
So, I can see that question. See, if you see the recent news, as it appeared in most of the news bulletin, there are 6 pharma companies who are working on this COVID-19 virus antivirus development, the vaccine for COVID-19. And one among them is our own company, Biologically. In addition to Biologically, there are Bharat Biotech, Serum Institute, and I think there are total 6 companies who are working in that. But as all of us know, it is a there are regulatory constraints or the regulatory guidelines to for a vaccine to come up, it takes minimum 2 to 5 years time. Following the clinical trials and other things. We hope that, that there are other companies in the USA or in UK, they are also working in that. So what the industry is talking to the regulatory bodies is to have some consideration in terms of cutting short the timelines on the clinical trial so that the vaccine can be made available. But in any case, unless the vaccine is injected to a person and see the behavior for 1 year, we will not come to know about the efficacy of the vaccine. So minimum 1 year it will take to the vaccines to come, as per my understanding, not being a regulatory guy. But for any vaccine to come up, it takes minimum 2 to 5 years. And hopefully India will be a leader in introducing this vaccine. There are 6 companies working on development of this vaccine.
Lakshmi, would you like to comment on this?
Yeah, in fact, as Mr. Vibhu said, that there are a good number of companies are working on these vaccines, and there are some positive news are coming up that they are going to. I mean, of course, the regulatory hurdles are there to clear the approvals for these vaccines. Generally, it takes minimum of 18 months at least. So probably in a couple of years we can see the vaccine, but before that, it's pretty difficult to see a vaccine in place. And apart from that, there are many number of companies who are acting on these immunomodulators and monoclonal antibodies for further cure of these diseases and all.
Okay. Rahulji, are you there?
Yes, very much.
Yeah, Rahulji, transport sector is considered as an unorganized sector where SOPs with respect to the sanitation is difficult to implement. So in a situation where you are carrying the pharma and other transporters are carrying the pharma, after the unloading, how do you take care of the sanitation part? Because the next load should be taken only after the sanitation.
So what we started doing was we found that a lot of these life-saving vaccines which are moving in from the Bombay airport, for example. So along with the association and one or two corporates, what we started doing about 10 days ago is we started sanitizing the cabins of the trucks in the SAR cargo, along with, you know, providing the masks and the sanitizers to the drivers and a food pack. So happy to inform that we have crossed 2,300 trucks till today in the last approximately about 17 days, which is more than about 120 trucks a day, which we are sanitizing. And yes, of course, being in the pharma trade and being in the cold chain space, definitely hygiene is a lot more important, and we are definitely a lot more organized than, you know, the typical, you know, transport companies. So we are doing our bit by providing the, you know, masks and the, you know, sanitizers to all our drivers, and also, you know, sending them information on WhatsApp on a daily basis on the do's and don'ts. Another initiative which was taken by the, you know, fueling agencies like IOCL and HPCL was that they were providing, at select outlets, maybe about 500 each across India, they were providing, food and sanitization facilities to the drivers, irrespective of whether we were buying the fuel from another brand. So that has also helped in a long way, because we were able to communicate this entire list with our drivers, and they were actually able to go there and, not only get fooding, but also rest and sanitization, especially since we all know that, you know, the dhabas had been locked down till very recently, and only now the government has given a clearance for them to open. Even today, you know, not even 10% of the dhabas are still open. So there is a lot of hardship and problems that they're facing en route. And we are doing our bit to help them through the associations as well as individually and through the corporates. We are getting tremendous support from all the corporates.
So what about the mindset of the drivers, the panic and the virus threat? How do you motivate them to come for a work?
See, there are a couple of things. One is that there is virtually no stoppage on route for, you know, essential vehicles, you know, as long as they're carrying the stickers. So, you know, because the toll booths are not being manned, and there is no police and RTO virtually on the road except for, you know, the checkpoints where they're checking the trucks. So there is a lot less human interaction on the highways than what was there usually. So that is one comforting factor for the drivers. Secondly, because these, you know, fuel stations en route had started these facilities of providing them, you know, sanitization and food. This has helped them in a, you know, long way to keep calm and, you know, to and then the additional incentives that all the transport companies are offering the drivers in this period is also helping them by way of, you know, giving them extra money. The toll has been suspended for a while, so that is an additional income which is going to the drivers, and the company is not making any money out of it. And additionally, the insurance which the government has announced for the, you know, healthcare workers, through the association, we are almost on the verge of getting the confirmation from the government to extend it to all the drivers who are, who have been plying. A database has been collected by the association, and I think we've crossed more than 100,000 trucks by now.
Thank you, Rahul. Somebody was asking about how to monitor the temperature remotely in the vehicle. Do you have any device or mechanism?
We are completely GPS enabled, and we are able to monitor the temperatures not only of the trucks but also of our warehouses, which are temperature controlled. And we have everything on the dashboard. We have the MIS team, which is either working from office or working from home. So the monitoring 24/7 continues undisrupted.
So I think that supply chain with respect to the cold chain is very much in place, and you're not finding difficulty in the intercity movement, except the driver food and the related thing, which is resolved now.
Which is partially resolved, I would say. The challenges that we are facing, and I think Lakshmi would also agree that, this problem we are facing is more of within the state and within the cities. The secondary movement is where the challenges still rest. But I believe that will also eventually get sorted. Primary movement is not a major challenge as of today, especially for the temperature control products.
Kamalji, I think there are a couple of people who have raised their hands. So I think
you can allow them.
Ask their name so that our people will unmute them.
I think this option is your side. I don't have that option.
Okay.
Yeah.
Give me just 10 seconds time.
In the meantime, Lakshmi, people would like to know what is the strategy we have to reduce the dependence on the China, because a lot of positive, negative we hear from about the China, and the dependence is little depressing.
Yes, in fact, this is a situation we have come across from so long time, and every association or every organization or every stakeholders have been debating on this aspect in each and every conference, I believe. And finally, see, there is a committee constituted long back, and the Katoch committee have given their detailed report in 2015 itself. Since then, there is a lot of noise has been hearing in almost every forum on this import dependency on China. But finally, at this point of time in COVID, the government has taken a call on this Katoch committee recommendations, and they have come up with these schemes and all. But perhaps if we could have taken these steps a bit earlier, then the situation could be in a better normal state rather than the current position of over-dependency on China. But going forward with these new schemes offered by the government, we feel definitely in coming couple of years or so, Indian industry, they have their know-how how to manufacture all these APIs. They know very well, but only for the sake of business or for the sake of monetary terms, they have lost those capabilities to China, and they have started working on generic space. But now with this understanding of the overall scenario, and even companies got to know how fragile the entire system of the country or system of the industry is right now. So on one side, industries are also looking forward to work on their own molecules, and on the other side, government is also offering the attractive benefits and incentives to the government. So certainly we believe probably in the coming years, the dependency could be reduced, and India could see as a new force in the space of API, I believe.
Please,
Kamalji, I think Rajat Godbole is on live. You can ask. Mr. Rajat, over to you, Kamalji.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Yeah.
Hello. Am I audible?
Rajat, you are audible.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Mr. Kiran for pointing out one very important point, that one has to be at peace and keep the team also at peace. And in continuation of that, because a lot many people have said about how fragile the supply chain and this whole ecosystem is, we at Concor are very much in a position to move containers up to seaports by even for reefer container movement. I understand that this session was more or less regarding the air cargo movement, but if at all there is any cargo that can be moved by rail, we can definitely facilitate the same. And secondly, as far as the cost part was concerned, and even like Kiran ma'am was telling about this movement from China, because the supply chains have to be restored. I'm told by my Chennai counterparts that the movement, intrastate movement is okay, but interstate movement is a little difficult. And I'm told by my Chennai team that they are in a position to move by rail, because right now the rail movement is one which is unhindered, so to speak. because even the passenger trains are not in the network right now. They are not moving. So the space is available for freight trains in a big way. So we are in a position to cater to all requirements. We are hoping that we can bring peace for all. And if there are any challenges, I request the panelists to please give your input so that we can work on those. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajat, for giving insight about the options available with respect to the sea cargo, the rail movement. Vibhuji, you wanted to say something. Vibhu, yeah. You were...
Kamalji, yeah. Can... Yeah, okay, after Vibhu. After
okay, let Rahul address it.
Nini, after you, sir. Vibhu, sir, please go ahead.
Okay, yeah. It's, I think for the domestic movement, for farmer population, I think Indian Railway, they are the Indian Railway, Indian Postal, they are now, their activities are more into distribution of essential and pharmaceutical goods. So for us, we have not availed the services of Indian Railway or Indian Post because we are managing with our existing stakeholder or partners. Who have been helping us in primary and secondary distribution. But yes, of course, the services of Indian Postal and Indian Railway at this point of time, we can acknowledge their service. They have actually come up to the expectation and to help the industry in moving their products.
Yeah, can I chip in? So what I would also suggest is, you know, if since Bibhu sir is also on the PDHF panel and, you know, maybe we could have Concor on that panel because I think our next call is scheduled for Friday and they could also bring their support, you know, because the entire pharma distribution heads will be there. And if, you know, anybody wants to use them, particularly maybe for raw material movement to the factories, which is still currently a bit disturbed, more than the finished goods, I think the RM movement would be of a great help through Concor.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Right. Okay. Let me just add here, Kamal.
Yeah, please, Satish.
Rajat, we've already been in discussion with you and Mr. Satyanarayana. I think that is not too far before it is completed. Huh?
Yeah, Kiranji, you were saying something.
Rajat, you can hear?
Yeah, settle me, sir.
Yeah. So I know that I've been talking to you all. I think that is something which, with Kamal and everyone's support, we will make it happen. Surely the reefer truck, reefer container movement as well.
True. So what are the challenges that you foresee in this kind of a movement? Because we have been talking a lot about in this panel also about the air cargo and the challenges and even the first mile and the last mile. But with regard to if containerized movement is to be done for reefer containers, what are the challenges that you foresee as at this stage?
Okay. One is the commercial aspect, because with all due respect to my pharma industry friends, they always look to a very important aspect of saying, iska price kya hoga? Okay. So first is that you experience the service, then you talk about price. My take always has been to the industry is that, look, experience the service. If you like the service, then you talk about price. Okay. So first thing is, let the train come in. I'm ready to invest. Run the train, let them experience the service, then we can talk about price, because I know the benefits that it gives of a larger inventory available for the pharma industry at Hyderabad. I think the basic thing is that their pain point today is that if to get a container, it takes 3 days from Bombay or even 4 days. And in a situation where we are now really facing the aspect of not able to get drivers, get trailers, get food, it is an ideal time to take this decision jointly. And I've repeatedly told, it is not my decision or Agility's own decision, but the industry should stand together, get more of big, large players together and get the train to happen. And it should be a commitment from all stakeholders, right from Kamal's team to Vibhu's team to everyone. And then Hyderabad will get a larger benefit. And I think more we do it together, it'll happen. You see, so that is the reality. So let us make it happen. I know there's commercial challenges that are there at the moment.
I think you rightly summarized, Satish. One is the commercial challenges. Another part is the mode of transportation is always decided by the time you have. If there is a time critical cargo, that will always go by the air, and where the customer can wait, they can think about the possibility of the reefer container, provided the facility is available.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think Mr. Kamaljian, D.D. Reddy is on live. So yeah. The next question is from him.
Yeah, Mr. Reddy.
Thanking all of our panelists and friends. It's very interesting for the.
So your internet is unstable, Mr. D.D. Reddy.
Yeah, I'm. You can't hear your voice, please.
Mr. Reddy, we are not able to hear you. If any difficulty, you can write back to us.
We can ask him to type it out if he's not able.
Yeah, there'll be.
So can you keep talking, Mr. Reddy? Can you keep talking?
No.
Mr. Reddy, can you keep talking?
Yeah.
You can ask a question.
Yeah, what Mr. Satish has told regarding the deeper container moment from It's also experiencing the challenges. So I think it's one of the.
No, sir, you are. Sorry, you have to. I mean, either you have. I mean, I think you are sitting in your cabin. You have to come out, or you have. Can you write it in the chat, Mr. D.D. Reddy? Mr. D.D. Reddy is from Aurobindo Pharma.
Okay, I will send.
Yeah. I think he's sending in the chat. Yeah. Can we move on to?
I think we the timings are given. We are at the end of the session.
If you can answer one question.
Yeah. In the meantime, if the question comes, we would like to answer respective panelists. Since the time is ending, I would like to hear one message from each panelist they would like to give to the industry. Saurabh ji.
So it's tough time. Have patience for a few weeks and we'll all be back to very close to normal. That's it.
Thank you. Bibuji.
Yeah, it's there is a saying which says that if there is a problem, the problem comes with a solution. And we all of us realize that this kind of problem is a critical situation. Everybody has come together and they just don't feel the people of India in terms of availability of essential goods or medicines. So we work together, we can come out, we can overcome any of the issues.
Thank you. Satish bhai.
I think the industry has been thanking the people from the medical community, the lot of other people. One on this panel, and with all respect to everyone in the logistics industry, I would like to thank each one of them who's putting their heart and soul to move the cargo in this very difficult time. So my heartfelt thank you that you are the brave soldiers. My congratulations to each one of you to come out and, you know, at this point of time, really, you know, help the world at this point of time. So my message is please keep moving the cargo, and this is a time to show our solidarity to the world.
I think Mr. D.D. Reddy has sent question, reefer container movement by rail from Hyderabad is a good option and we can avoid road traffic in such critical situations. Satish, you can take up this question.
Mr. Reddy, really true. So we've been working on it with Concor. After the FTTCI conference, I had taken this up. It had given me all the required information. So you should be seeing a train soon coming into Hyderabad for reefer container movement. That all I can tell you. The date and time we will announce very shortly.
Kiranji, your message to the industry.
The same thing. Actually, this COVID-19 has connected back the humanity at a deeper level. Be there for people. Be there for your team. Be there for your family. Be there for your company. Things will start unfolding. Just be there.
Great, Kiran. You're talking a lot of spirituality. Good. Lakshmi.
Yeah, I believe this is the learning time for all of us to understand what we are exactly and what the system and what are the needs of the country and a whole. And we, everybody has to learn how to serve the humankind at this particular hardships and all. And being in the pharma fraternity, I feel so proud to serve for the humankind at this unprecedented times.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Thank you. Rahul Ji.
I think this current situation has taught us patience, taught us how to collaborate, and especially, you know, get a lot of respect for the drivers and laborers who are now out of action. I think they are the people who will remember the most. Thanks.
Good, good. Rahulji, I think as Satish and you said, the supply chain industry is working hard to put the things in right perspective, delivering the things, because the pharma industry has interdependence on the supply chain industry. And the effective supply chain can give you the medicine at your doorstep, whether it's a warehousing, the transport, the custodian, the air freight, or the logistics service provider of any type. So I would like to thank all the panelists for being precise and giving the messages. And I'm confident that the participant will get the desired information and something to implement in respective business and the workplaces. Now, over to Deepthi Gubba for further proceeding.
So thank you, Kamalji. So it has been a very wonderful platform. And, you know, all the speakers who have contributed here have spoken about very valuable things, which is needed to the industry at this point of time. With respect to the supply chain, with respect to the transport, with respect to the technology, with respect to the air freight, with respect to the companies, what they are dealing, right from people to the products. So thank you so much. Thank you, each of you, for contributing here, for accepting our invitation and being here, serving the people, serving the pharma fraternity. So saying this, I would like to end this webinar. And anything else, Kiran?
That's it, Deepthi.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you
all.
Thank you to all of you. Thank you.
Jai.
Jai.